Hi, this is Chris Osborne with Osborne Conflict Resolution, and what I'm going to describe briefly in this short video is what the options are when somebody is facing separation and divorce, particularly in the state of North Carolina. You have a number of options for how to deal with the issues that arise under these circumstances. This first part is the issues that have to be dealt with in any separation. And as I have explained to many clients over the years, nobody is planning for a separation to happen, usually when they get married. It's all happiness and celebration, and you basically set off on what I call metaphorically the SS marriage, the ship that you're planning to go somewhere on together, and you're thinking it's going to be a good, enjoyable trip, and you may be sailing together. You said vows, it probably said forever, till death do us part. Unfortunately, one or the other of you becomes unhappy, discontent, very upset with what's going on to the point that you want to separate, then you end up crashing on the beach of a place that you never hoped to be. It's a destination that nobody ever set sails for. It's like the Bermuda Triangle. If you end up here, it's because something's gone wrong. And I'm metaphorically calling it Separation Island, not to make light of it, not to make it sound like vacation. It's not. Think Bermuda Triangle more than some kind of paradise. But the reality is, if either spouse in North Carolina wants to separate, which means leaves the marital home, wherever you all are residing as a couple, when you leave with the intent not to resume the marriage for any amount of time, that is a separation. And that commences a legal separation. There's nothing formal that has to be done beyond that. You are separated at that point, unless and until you were to return to the relationship. As long as you maintain separate places where you lay your head at night, and as long as you don't resume the relationship, and as long as you continue that intent not to resume, you are separated. And that's why it's kind of a place that you find yourself. And one spouse can't control whether you end up there if the other one wants to be there. If either party says we're separate, I'm separating, then you are separated. So what we're going to look at is, well, what does that mean? Where are you now? Where are we going? And then in a second video, I'm going to talk about how we're going to get there, because that is really the most important decision when you're at this point. Now, again, a separation could result in any amount of time on Separation Island, and I'll talk about it in just a moment. You could also reconcile. Separation in North Carolina does not mean you're automatically getting divorced. It's not over. Sometimes people separate for a time period in order to do some work on the relationship, to do some healing, to try to get some patterns taken care of, to deal with maybe the results of an affair, or one partner or the other having substance abuse issues or mental illness or things like that. And sometimes you have to separate in order for that healing to best happen, but it doesn't mean you're going to necessarily end up divorced. And I've had several clients, I've had several friends who have separated for a time, and they end up getting the healing that they need, and they get back together, they get back on the boat, and they actually go where they went to go. Some of them are still married today. I have one set of friends who actually separated, got divorced, and then got remarried because they turned their relationship around. So great things like that can happen. But the other way that a separation ends, if you don't reconcile, and that is in divorce. And in North Carolina, the qualification for divorce, the only test that has to be met, the only thing that matters, and you may read this elsewhere, is 1 year of physical separation without intent to resume the marriage. You have to wait that year, but it's North Carolina law. The good news is you don't have to prove some reason. You don't have to prove that you have grounds to leave the marriage. You don't have to establish that the other person was a terrible spouse or anything like that, but you do have to prove that you've been separate for 1 year. And then after that, you can ask the court to enter a judgment of divorce. And what that means is you're leaving Separation Island. You're leaving the status of being separated in separate boats. And each of you is going your own way on your own with your own transportation from that point on. So the law of separation then is about governing what happens during the time that you have to be separated, during at least that year. Sometimes it's a little bit more, but it can't be less than a year until you get a divorce. And people often ask, that feels unfair and it's frustrating, and other states don't have it, such a long deadline, such a long period of time. But in North Carolina, it's a year. And so we gotta have some rules and regulations, some kind of understanding of what happens during that time. And that's what the law of separation and family law is about. And I'm gonna walk quickly through the issues that you have to cover. If there are children in the marriage, then, of course, a big important issue is child custody and visitation. While you're not living in the same house, you have to figure out where are the kids going to stay, who's going to get them to and from school, how are you going to share time with them? You're going to be in separate homes, but still one family unit operating. And if you have a situation with children, then one parent often is entitled to some level of support from the other. Sometimes people can work this out. Sometimes it has to be enforced or it has to be adjudicated. But child support is an important issue for the time period of separation. It also applies on into the future as well, but it at least gets started and gets established during separation while you're in this limbo state on separation island. And then there's another kind of support that you may have heard about called spousal support. And spousal support comes in two different formats, and these names are usually more familiar. The first is post-separation support. Post-separation support is basically when one spouse has made less money than the other. One or the other spouse is probably the breadwinner. Oftentimes, there might be one breadwinner and one person who doesn't work, or both spouses might be employed. For purposes of North Carolina law, all that the law looks at is the actual salaries. And it compares, and whoever makes more money is the supporting spouse. Whoever makes less money is the dependent spouse. And post-separation support is a remedy that's available under the law for somebody who hasn't been working, but their spouse has. And now the separation is happening. That person who hasn't been working may not have a job, may not find a job, may take some time to get a job. The point is that separation island is, by definition, it's transitional. And it's designed to help the spouse who hasn't had income get back on their feet. So it can be a court order or an agreement for the supporting spouse to pay money towards the living expenses of the dependent spouse for some period of time. And that period of time is not, there's no definite formula for that. There's never definite formula for the amount. What the court looks at is the relative earning power or income or available salary of the two spouses and the expenses that each one also has to incur for their living. And I won't go into the depths of the calculations of that now, but just know that if you are a person who is primarily reliant on the income of your spouse, you're not gonna be left high and dry. They either have to agree to, or they're going to be ordered to pay some amount of money towards your living expenses, at least for some transitional period. And then the other category of spousal support is alimony. And alimony you might have heard of, and people have all kinds of expectations and thoughts about that, but alimony basically is the same thing as post-separation support, but it endures past separation. Is there some period of time on into the future that the supporting spouse has to pay the dependent spouse some amount of money? Alimony is determined by a list of 21 factors. I'm not going to go into all of them here. You may have heard that there are different factors that relate to whether either spouse has been unfaithful. That's a little bit complicated and beyond the scope of what we're talking about here. The bottom line is most separations that lead to a divorce might have, not most, but many, have some component of alimony, which is just a longer duration of usually monthly payments. And the key to remember there is the alimony is designed to help if you are going to both end up on the separate boats, maintaining separate households. And again, the court will pay attention to the equities of the situation and what resources the dependent spouse has for supporting themselves. And so that is a forward-looking thing for leaving separation island. The last really financial piece of what has to be or what is often determined while you're on separation island. It does not have to be determined technically while you're there, but most couples who know that their separation is heading towards divorce start looking at that. In North Carolina, we call it equitable distribution. It's basically dividing the property of the marriage and any debts incurred during the marriage. And I'm not going to go deep into the definitions of those terms, but basically we identify what assets were acquired during the marriage, either the couple deciding to purchase things together or money that either of them earned during the marriage was spent on, if you acquired furniture, if you bought a home, things like that. And also debts incurred during the marriage are presumably marital debts that benefited both of you. These are also distinguished from separate assets. You might have something that you owned before the marriage and you might just keep it after the marriage. You might have debt in a similar fashion. Lots of people incur student loan debt, for example. That is not considered a marital debt. If you come in with a debt, you would go out with that debt most likely. But there's some complicated rules about applying. What if somebody helped pay another person's loans and things like that? And those kind of factors are also taken into account by a court when determining. But basically, it's what does each party take with them out of this relationship? We look at what they had when they came in, but we also look at what they acquired together. And the court is basically looking to make this equitable or fair. And the presumption is essentially with regard to marital assets, if it was acquired during the marriage, if it's a marital asset, if it's an IRA that was deposited into during the marriage and matched by the employer and it's grown during the marriage, that's a marital asset. And all those are divided 50-50, presumably. There is a lot that goes into figuring out what is the best division of assets because you want each party to end up with liquid cash. You have to pay attention to the tax value of different assets and whether something that's valued at $100,000, but it's in an IRA or a 401k, and so it can't be accessed without tax consequences. You pay attention to that sort of thing in trying to come to a balancing of what's reasonable, what's fair, and allows both parties moving forward. So equitable distribution is something you start talking about during separation. You may or may not resolve it fully before the divorce. Lots of times the timing ends up that the equitable distribution is ready to happen at the time of divorce or just after. You can get it resolved ahead of time if it's not too complicated. And then the last thing that we encourage people just to think about is, of course, if there are children in the marriage, there's one more consideration. Each party is going to move on and establish their own household. They may enter another relationship or they may not. But if there are children, then their boat can't necessarily go super far away from each other because there will always be a co-parenting relationship. There's always going to be something, those kids, tying them together, meaning they've got to figure out how to communicate and get along and have an orderly plan for the exchange of the kids and custody and visitation. And that is a fact that is reality, and different couples choose to handle that in different ways. And we're not going to go into the details about that. It's just something to be mindful of that eventually has to be addressed only when there's kids involved. So that's the overview of the legal issues that you have to deal with during separation. I'll talk about your methodology choices, your process choices on how to get there, because that's a really important decision at this point in time. And so when you're ready, you can watch part two of this video. Thanks so much.